haven't found it.
Wouldn't do me no good because I can't see it.
Yeah, no, you can't see it.
I can't see the set list.
Yeah, I know all the words till I start. Then they go away from me.
Leroy, would you like any lighting changes, maybe?
Yeah, pick up and down a bit. Woo!
Feel like your interrogation.
Oh, you've been there too.
Who ate all that popcorn at the game with Katie? It weren't me.
Woo! Well, you can tell if I'd eaten chili. I mean, never mind. I won't go there.
Somebody go there and sell Tums.
What's that?
I'm gonna go there and sell Tums.
That might be worth it.
I'm selling it.
Did you ever see the thing up? Oh, remember somebody sent me this email probably 10, 15 years ago about a New Jersey guy that ends up being the judge at a Texas chili contest. Funniest thing I've ever read.
Yeah, I've read it.
Oh, God.
You need to find that by Saturday night.
Yeah, maybe I'll read it rather than play and sing. This is a song that I actually get requests for. Usually I get requests, you know, shut up, go away, but this has got a little story behind it. A number of years ago, I was working kind of like a school social worker, and I was interviewing a young lady. She had a kid, I guess, about 4 and another, maybe 6 months or so, I can't remember. But anyway, the little four-year-old was going through some testing to see if he would be able to receive any kind of special education. And as part of that, I had to do a family social history, as we call it. So in talking to the young lady, she was about 25, she was married to, well, she's that old, in her 20s, married to a guy maybe late 40s, early 50s, and they had a little four-year-old, and then she had a infant, maybe 6 months, maybe a year. And it turned out that the four-year-old was hers and her husband's, and the father of her little baby was her, what would you call it? Anyway, it was her father, her husband's son was the father of the young one. And the whole time I'm sitting there interviewing, I'm thinking about this song that I've seen the lyrics to. I'm trying to let that roll around in my head, trying to figure out how the relationship of the two kids, the mother, the father, the, I guess it, I don't know if her son would, his son would be her brother-in-law, or I don't know. It, all these things went around in my head, and I couldn't figure. Anyway, made me think of this song. Many, many years ago, I was 23. I was married to a widow who was pretty as can be. This widow had a grown-up daughter who had hair of red. My father fell in love with her, and soon they two were wed. Now this made that my son-in-law and changed my very life. Daughter was my mother, for she was my father's wife. To complicate the matter, even though it brought me joy, I soon became the father of a bouncing baby boy. My little baby then became me brother-in-law to dad. So became my uncle, though it made me very sad. For if he was my uncle, then that also made him brother to the widow's grown-up daughter, who of course was my stepmother. Now I'm my own grandpa. I'm my own grandpa. It may sound funny, I know, but it really is so. Oh, I'm my own grandpa. My old father's wife and had a son who kept him on the run. He became my grandchild, for he was my daughter's son. My wife is now my mother's mother, and it makes me blue, because although she is my wife, she's my grandmother too. And if my wife is my grandmother, then I am her grandchild. And every time I think of it, it nearly drives me wild. For now I have become the strangest case you ever saw. As husband to my grandmother, I am my own grandpa. I'm my own grandpa. I know, but it really is so. Oh, I'm my own grandpa. I'm my own grandpa. I'm my own grandpa. It may sound funny, I know, but it really is so. Oh, I'm my own grandpa. That song was about you or about your family.
I'm sorry for
that. That's a disclaimer to you. You got other problems.
Odd yes. Family reunion.
What's that?
It'd be an odd family reunion.
Hmm. You know it, Richard. What am I going to do next? Let's see. Move my gun. I might whistle if my whistle is wet. Trying to think what the song is. She ain't rolled, but she ain't bad. She's the best girl I ever had. red bone. Thank you. Let's see what we're going to do next time, huh? Yeah, let me know when I got like one more to do, so I...
Okay.
Chris Christopherson song. One of my favorite songwriters. Maybe a song that you aren't familiar with. On one of his albums, by this title, of Silver Tongue Devil and I. Not always, not necessarily my favorite song by him, but it's one I enjoy. I took myself down to the Tally Ho Tavern to buy me a bottle of beer. I set me down by a tender young maiden, and I was as dark as her hair. And as I was searching bottle to bottle for something unfoolish to say, that silver-tongued devil slipped from the shelves and smilingly stole her away. And I said, hey, little girl, don't you know he's a devil? He's everything that I ain't. Hiding the tensions of evil intentions under the smile of a saint. All is good for his getting in trouble and shifting his share of the blame. And some people swear he's my double, and some even say we're the same. But the silver-tongued devil's got nothing to lose. I only live till I die. We take our own chances and pay our own dues. Oh, the silver-tongued devil and I. Like all the fair maidens laid down beside him, she knew in her heart that he'd lie. And nothing that I could have said could have saved her, no matter how hard they tried. Cause she'll offer her charms through the darkness and danger of something that she's never known. Open her arms to the smile of a stranger, full of her, and leave her alone. Oh, he's a devil. He's everything I ain't. Hiding intentions of evil intentions under the smile of a saint. All is good for his getting in trouble and shifting his shatter of the flame. Some people swear he's my double, and some even say we're the same. But the silver-tongued devil's got nothing to lose, and I only live till I die. We take our own chances, pay our own dues. That silver-tongued devil and by. Okay, I'll make this a long one. I like story songs. And one of the best story songwriters that I've, well, one of my favorites anyway, Gordon Lightfoot. And this is a story of Edmund Fitzgerald. No need to get into it, you know it. Legend. The legend lives on from the Chippewa home down of the big lake they call Eugene and me. And the lake, it is said, never gives up her dead when the skies of November turn gloomy. With a load of iron ore, 26,000 tons more than the Edmund Fitzgerald went empty. that good ship and crew was a bone to be chewed when the gales of November came early. The ship was the pride of the American side, coming back from some mill in Wisconsin. As the big freighters go, it was bigger than most, with a crew and good captain well seasoned. On flirting sometimes with a couple of steel firms when they left fully loaded for Cleveland. And later that night when the ship's bell rang, could it be the north wind they'd been feeling? The wind and the wire made a telltale sound when the wave broke over the railing. And every man knew, as the captain did too, 'cause a witch of November comes stealing. The dawn came late and the breakfast had to wait when the gales of November came slashing. Afternoon came, it was freezing rain in the face of a hurricane west wind. Came on deck, saying, "Fellas, it's too rough to fish up." At 7 p.m., the main hatchway caved in. He said, "Fellas, it's been good to know ya." Well, the captain wired in, he had water coming in. The good ship and crew were in peril. And later that night, when his lights went out of sight, came the wreck of the Edmund Fitzgerald. Does anyone know where the love of God goes when the waves turn minutes to hours? Searchers all say they have made Whitefish Bay if they put 15 more miles behind her. Might have split up or they might have capsized. They may have broke deep ends of water. All that remains are the faces and the names of the wives and of the sons and of the daughters. Huron rolls, Superior sings in the rooms of her ice-watered mansion. Old Michigan steams like a young man's dreams. The islands and bays are for sportsmen. And farther below, Lake Ontario takes in what Lake Erie can send her. And the iron boats go, as the mariners all know, with the gales of November remembered. In a dusty old hall in Detroit, they prayed, and the out of turn of page, because they couldn't read the words. Maritime Sailors Cathedral. The church bell chimed and it rang 29 times for each man on the Edmund Fitzgerald. I said the legend lives on from the Chippewa down of the big lake they call Kitchikamee. Superior, they said, never gives up her dead when the gales of November come early. Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Dave, Bart, where did you go?
Thanks, everyone.
What else is wrong?